I've got a 2008 GMC half ton pickup with a 5.3 liter. That's the family vehicle right now. You're probably wondering, well, Scott, what are you gonna drive back and forth to work and around town? Well, I'm driving the Ram. My Yukon is on a trailer. That's not good. And I think I know what's wrong with it, and it's not good. But if you recognize this windmill, hi windmill, you probably know where I'm at. And the reason why my Yukon is here is because my wife and my family decided to drive out to Buffalo, New York for Christmas. We do that every 2 years. And on the way out, I think I dropped a valve in my motor in that Yukon, which is not good, which means I got to pull the motor out. Yeah. Anyways, 3 weeks later, we got back home, and then I came back out here to Tony's place to pick up the vehicle. Now, you're probably wondering, what did I do for a vehicle? Well, that thing was stuck. Tony's parents were very generous in letting us use their Yukon, and we drove that all the way out to Buffalo, drove it home. I put it on a trailer, hauled it here, and then I'm getting my Yukon, and Tony helped me lift it, put it on there, and yeah, and I'm gonna take it back home, and first things first is figure out what's going on with that, and hopefully I can fix it. Anyways, let's go inside and see what kind of shenanigans this guy's got going on. And the best part about these shops is there's stuff everywhere. You don't have a shop unless there's stuff everywhere, because that means you're working on stuff.
Are you complaining about my dirty shop?
It's the worst ever. You really need to like get, I don't know, like one of those Shark, you know, cleaners, let them go around the floor and like mop it.
I'm looking for somebody whose sole ambition is keeping my shop clean.
But exactly. Anyways, this is Tony Fast. If you don't know who Tony Fast is, he's a guy that, I don't know, somehow farms like 5 hours away from us, and he does really good, and he's got big tools, like a 100-foot Bargo air seater. It's like a 1,300 bushel cart. I don't know. All those fun big toys. He's a big farmer.
Similar size farms.
Yeah, it's pretty similar.
A little bit different climates.
So this is the Peterbilt. It's not the Beaterbilt. It's the Peterbilt that is beautiful and shiny and gorgeous. And it shouldn't be on a farm because it's too nice.
New truck.
That's Tim. He's kind of like the tool man, you know, like Tim the tool man.
This actually all started because Scott's kind of one of my biggest fans, so he just wanted to show up.
I am depriving him. I'm depriving this guy of a signature just to make him a little sad, just because I can, and I know it's going to work. Am I a jerk? Absolutely. I'm totally one of those guys.
Yeah.
See his face?
He goes so far to blow up a Suburban motor just to meet me.
Just to come back again.
He did offer me a 5.9 Cummins to put in the Suburban, or the Yukon, I should say.
Suburban.
Anyways, yeah, this is a pretty sweet setup. And then I hear Tony has got this thing like boosted to like 715, right?
685.
685?
Yeah.
Anyways, if you guys haven't checked out Fast Egg, you should. Now that I'm hauling my Yukon back, let me tell you a little bit what happened. So we're driving out to Buffalo, New York. We stopped in at Tony and Amy's place, spent the night there, left her in the morning, and we drove about an hour away, and my wife wanted some coffee, so we stopped to get some coffee. We wait for a few minutes, and all of a sudden, the whole vehicle shook, like violently shook. And I noticed that my engine was kind of bouncing around in RPMs, and so I was like, all right, let me floor it a little bit to try to get it to, I thought it was a computer glitch and it was just misfiring. So I tried to floor it and got it to rev up a little bit, and then I let off the throttle and then it just died. There was no banging, there was no knocking, no sounds at all. Just vehicle shaking, and then when I let off, it died. And then Tony and Amy's parents were very generous and let us use their Yukon to drive out to Buffalo, New York and back. I'll tell ya, that act of kindness was overwhelming for me and my family. I felt so overwhelmed by just the nice charity that they had to let us take their vehicle and drive it that far and back. And that was, thank you. That's all I have to say to them. I don't know how else to express my appreciation. So anyways, that's the deal. Things happen, guys, you know, and in the moment it's not really pleasant and it's not fun, but you know what, we'll get it figured out. And it's just stuff, you know. At least we didn't get in a wreck and my family's fine, you know, that we didn't get hurt, nobody's, you know, injured. That's the main thing. We are back. We meaning me, myself, and I. This is going to come off the trailer, and I'm going to take the two-post car lift and lift it right off the trailer, drive the trailer out from underneath it, and then we're going to start to diagnose and find out exactly what happened to this motor. Yeah, I don't think it's going to be good, but I have a feeling like 99% sure, that's how sure I am, 99% sure, not 99.9%. Anyways, then I'm going to have to pull this motor. I love this vehicle. I love it. That 6.2 in there gets great mileage. Oh, fantastic mileage. And it's got great power. Love it. Just not the DOD fuel management system that GM puts in their vehicles. And that stuff is garbage. I understand what they're trying to do, but they've been around long enough. GM needs to knock it off and stop making new vehicles with that system because it's garbage. For all of you that know what it is, you understand. But this thing, when I get done, it will not have it. And it should be more reliable. Hopefully. We'll see. Anything man-made will break down, so I'm not expecting this thing to be perfectly reliable. Just saying. I understand. But I'm going to try to make it so it lasts longer. That's what I'm trying to do. All right. Let's pull it off the trailer. Now, let's see the damage. Yeah, looks fine to me. What do you think? So, this is what I'm gonna do. I am going to pull out each spark plug, put a scope in there, and see if I can see anything concerning to the eye. And hopefully, it'll be the first spark plug I pull out, so I don't have to go through all of them. You see what I see? Yeah, that's not good. Whoever took this off, and it wasn't me, did not put it on correctly. See how that's curled back? That's not a good sign. This has been sucking dirt in the motor ever since I've owned it. And who knows, before me, who knows how long they were driving it like that. So I'm just gonna suspect that dirt going in the engine had something to play with the problem of the motor. Now, granted, here's something to think about. These heads have it designed where the injector is in the head and it shoots it right into the cylinder. And that's how they can get way better mileage out of it. But if you think about it, that fuel that should be going through the ports of the head isn't. So it's not washing your ports going into your head. So all that dirt and junk that's getting around your valves is getting built up. So who knows, maybe all this dirt that it's been sucking got up in the valve that goes up and down inside your head and wedged it in there, got enough friction in there, and it finally stuck, piston hit the valve. It's possible that happened. The other thing possible is maybe a valve spring broke and then the valve was flopping in the side there and it finally fell inside and well, as you can tell, the engine stopped. I don't know yet. There's a couple things that I could think about. It could be that DOD, you know, the fuel management system in here and a lifter went bad and then it bent a valve and then the valve dropped or something like that. It's hard to say. My suspicion is it's definitely not a connecting rod, and I shouldn't say definitely, but I'm going to highly suspect that a connecting rod didn't come out because I didn't hear any banging. I didn't hear any knocking. It literally just blah. So we'll find out when we get closer. Now I got that off, I gotta pull these covers here to pull my spark plugs out. And I'll tell you one thing, I'm gonna need a step stool because I'm not a very tall guy. I'm only 5'10", for crying out loud. Well, I don't see anything wrong with this spark plug, but it's possible that the valve didn't smack the spark plug.
It's just a loser. GMC would buy. You got the 6.2. It just.
Stop it! It's not funny!
I never owned one of those.
No! I don't like this anymore!
I decided it'd be better for me to just go ahead and just take the valve cover off. And here's the last spark plug, so I already went and took the bolts off. There we go.
The spring has just broke apart. You know what? I think I threw it all away. I had a whole bunch of extras of these.
I don't think it's on this side. I think it's the other side. So far, all the valve springs look good. The rocker arms look good. And the push rods look good on this side. So that means it's on the other side. At least that's what it's looking like.
Which, the trickier side.
Yeah, Nick just said it's the trickier side. He's pointing and laughing at me like nonstop, and he's giggling into himself. And I'm kind of like, I deserved it. Because I do it to him quite a bit. So I got to pull this side off and see what it is. All right, my cameraman was not recording when I pulled the valve cover off. So you guys got to see what happened.
All right.
Valve spring broke, and there's a valve inside the piston.
Funny thing is, these are the blue ones, and they're supposed to be the better ones. The yellow ones are supposed to be the bad springs. So these are like kind of a baby blue, though, so maybe they're a little different.
Okay, what I want to know is the needle bearings in this. They look like they're intact.
So yeah, I don't think with the spring breaking, that's a faulty spring.
Yep.
Spring disintegrated.
Okay, that's exactly what I suspected. That is really, really annoying, Nick, by the way. Oh. Stop it. Stop it!
Not usually the cameraman.
You know, if this guy wasn't the CEO of YouTube, Welker Farms YouTube, I'd fire him. Stop! Let me explain. Okay, this is your valve spring, okay? Here's your rocker arm.
Sorry.
You guys get the idea.
Easily distracted.
I'm done.
The springs keep the valve tight.
Yes. This is not good to have two pieces.
No. That's a bad day. I'm going to call and see if they put new ones in mine.
And to replace it on yours, Nick, it's going to be a chore.
To change that?
Well, yeah. You got to have the piston at top dead center every single time.
To keep the valve from falling inside.
And then you got to try to reach in there and somehow compress the spring.
Fun.
Yeah. All right. Motor's going to be pulled probably. Most likely. I think I'm gonna have to pull it off the top. Easier to come out the top instead of the side of the vehicle. Oh! Not looking good! You wanna see the spark plug that just came out? Yeah! Yeah, there's aluminum pieces and it's damaged pretty good. you just gotta laugh. All right, let me put a scope in there and see if I can see what I can see. And I'll try to show you guys. This camera's not very good, but not cool. Okay, This camera system isn't very good at all, but I'm going to try to show you guys what it looks like, and it's really hard to see in there, but I'm pretty sure the valve is facing towards the, like, the flat part of the valve. I think it's facing towards the head. I think it flipped around and then it punched itself right through the piston. It's hard to tell on that camera. Pull that. Wow, that's pretty bad. Pretty bad. Hopefully it didn't damage the block too bad, because that's what I need. I need the block. The other components, I can get. The block, that's the problem. Yeah. Okay. Well, let's pull the radiator fluid. It's bleeding. Luckily, they had a little valve on the bottom of the radiator so I could just drain it out instead of trying to take a hose off and make a complete mess. Because some engineers, and I think they all do it, don't give you that option to just open a valve and drain it. They make sure that you have to make a mess. I don't know why they do that, but this one was really nice and convenient, so thank you. Right? Okay, I gotta take off. Looks like two more bolts on the exhaust manifold on this side. Get that out of the way, let that drain down, and then once it's pretty drained down, yeah, pull off stuff.
Piston is toast.
Okay, you ready to see the head?
Oh, it's banged up all right. I don't think there's much they can do. I mean, it's, I don't know.
Thank you. Wow. It's hollow. It's a hollow tube.
I have no idea. Wait, I'm not sure. How's that piston look?
Well, the piston's gonna have to be replaced.
Cylinder wall is the question.
If you look in here, right there is a little bit of a gouge. It looks like a kind of a moon shape where the valve kind of slid up the sidewall. But other than that, there's not like big scratches in it. So it's very possible that this might have to be bored out 10 to 20,000s like Nick's was, and then oversized pistons. And then we'll do the bulletproof, hopefully bulletproof, DOD delete. And then we're gonna put new valve springs on the heads. I might have to get a new head, depending on what they think of it. I think it's gonna have to be a new one.
Yeah, I don't know if they can salvage that. It's pretty bad. I mean, you could.
Right.
You could clean it up. You'd get a Dremel and clean up those rough edges, and I mean, it would run. Is it gonna mess the compression?
It all depends on like the valve. Like, so where the valve goes up in the head, there's a couple different angles that are called seats. So you have like, one's called like the throat, the face, there's some other, I think that's what they call them, correct me if I'm wrong, but there's terms for each angle. And if that angle gets kind of cut out wrong, they have to cut it again.
It feels fine, honestly.
But
yeah, you can see where the valve hit right there.
Oh wow, it went into the head.
But you know, this one's got a, it smacked right there. As long as this one's okay, I don't know about that. All this, you know, you could Dremel and they'll know. You clean all that up, I think.
I mean, it's,
I think you could reuse this head personally, but as long as
you're probably not going to notice that much of a, like,
was the spark plug broke off?
Yeah, it was, where did I put that spark plug? It was kind of mangled up right here.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it definitely, I just think it needed a new spark plug in there, but apparently that's not the problem. Wow, okay, well, that answers that question. The nice thing was, is I wasn't cruising down the interstate going like 80 some miles an hour and then getting those RPMs way up there and boom. It was idling when it happened. So that, by the grace of God, I think he helped save my motor from being a bad block and thrown in the iron pile. Because if I need to get a block, that's going to be a problem. Nick knows exactly how that is.
Yeah, unicorns.
Mm-hmm. I called to a dealership just to see what the waiting time is. And they said they ordered one 4 months ago, still haven't seen it. One took 8 months to get. And that's just the long block, so heads, pistons, valves, and all that put together. That was just that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Kind of sad. Powerful motor, great mileage, but this makes you a little kind of scared to run them. But I still like them for some reason. I don't know why. All right, I'm going to call it quits. I finally got it opened up to see exactly what was going on, and it was just driving me nuts. I wanted to find out, and I found out, and you guys found out too. So I'm going to go home and spend some time with my family. Nick too. So basically, what I got to do right now is it was easier for me to pull the head off and then reach behind. There's four bolts on top of the engine and transmission, and then down below it's going to be easier for me to disconnect those. So I got to pull those bolts off. I still have to take off the vacuum lines to the vacuum pump here. I got to take off the engine mounts and then a few other brackets, undo the torque converter bolts, and then hook it up to a cherry picker. And then from my understanding, I've watched a lot of videos, and by the way, this is not a how-to video. There's lots of videos on YouTube on how to do this. This is more of like, I'm gonna show you the process of what I gotta go through. So anyways, I hear separating the transmission engine is not very fun. Hopefully, keyword, hopefully I won't have that problem. I'm hoping it'll just kind of come off and not too bad. And I want to make sure I don't damage the transmission aluminum housing and the engine aluminum housing, or back of the engine. You know, I don't want to damage any of that. So I got to be careful. So, yeah. All right. Next step is those engine bolts on the back of the, for the transmission. And I'm going to grab, I believe it's a 15 millimeter right here. There's one. Right there. See it? And then there's one right here. And then there's another one right here and one right there. Remove those, get those out of the way, and then the next step is to do a couple extra electrical connections on the front of the motor, motor mounts, torque converter, other bolts, cherry picker, and I think I'm out. We'll find out. All right, let's get this done. All right, we got the torque converter bolts out. There's six of them right here with Nick's help. He was able to move the crankshaft and then hold it in position, and then I could take them off. Oh, there's a sensor right here I gotta take off too.
No, you leave that on and let it stretch.
Oh.
Yeah, oh, that's the one that has to stretch. They showed that in the video.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, make sure you use a cherry picker and lift it, you know, pretty high.
I lost my hat into the coolant, so I'm gonna be hatless. I feel naked, to be honest. It's weird. All right, we are pretty much ready to pull the motor. So I need to grab a cherry picker or engine hoist or whatever people call it. I've always called it a cherry picker. Why? Probably because it picks cherries. I don't know why I call it the cherry picker, but that's what I call it. I got stuff everywhere. How do I work in this environment? Well, somehow. But I'm pretty sure I'm ready to pull it. Good feeling, knowing that it's ready to pull. I called the machine shop, and that Nick is here. And they said maybe in a couple weeks, depending on how it looks, they'll be able to get at it. Yeah. That's fun. Okay. Hopefully they can machine that out because it kind of... I sure hope they can get this little divot. You can't really see it on camera. Yeah, maybe you can, but it doesn't look too good. The valve just scooped out the side of the cylinder wall, and hopefully they can get it machined enough where it's still good. But we'll get that motor back in, and I'm going to put the hood back on, push it out, put it in the building, and get this block taken down to a machine shop. Boy, that sucks. It is what it is. You can't do much about it. Just gotta roll with it. Right? Fun. Oh well. Make it happen. Alright, vehicle's out of the shop. The shop is fairly clean for the most part. Tools are put away, and I've got the block for my 6.2 taken down to a machine shop, and they are going through it to see what they can do. There's a couple things they might be able to do. One, if the cylinder wall isn't cut out enough, I mean too bad, they could probably bore it out 10,000ths to 20,000ths, maybe, and you might be able to get away with it. If not, they got to cut the whole hole out with the metal sleeve, that aluminum block, take that out of there, heat the block up to like 200, 300 degrees, whatever it is, and then take a really cold sleeve and slide it in there, let it seat, cool down, and then they might be able to machine the rest of the cylinders depending on how bad they look. Maybe they look good, maybe they can hone it. I don't know. But they're going to take care of it. So here's the deal. to get a reman block could take about 4 to 8 months out. That's if you can get one. But then you still have that DOD junk, the fuel management control. And that stuff is garbage. Absolutely garbage. And to be honest, I feel like all the new vehicles are pretty much garbage. The quality's not there. There's so much electrical stuff going on and so many sensors. And it's not if, it's when you're gonna have a problem. And any place you take your vehicle, you're gonna pay a fortune to get it fixed. And if you can get the parts. And questionable if the parts are any good. So we all know that doesn't matter what brand you got. Doesn't matter. But it's all about preference of what you think is best and what you like. And to be honest, I'm personally a GM guy. I've loved the GM vehicles from the 80s and the 90s and early 2000s were pretty darn bulletproof vehicles. So things happen, you just roll with it, and we're gonna get this thing back and going. It's gonna be a while. And yeah, isn't that something? Valve spring. That's all it took to do maybe anywhere from $5,000 to $7,000 of damage. And that's just in parts for me. Yeah, and I'm gonna do the work. Imagine if I took it to a shop and had them do it. Yeah, that'd be bad. So anyways, things happen, you just roll with it. And you know what? In all things, God is good. He's blessed us with many things, and that's just how it is. Saying that, you guys are great, you're awesome, and we'll catch you later. God bless, guys, appreciate it.